As we continue moving forward, looking at various epistles, we have looked at Ephesians, we want to move to Colossians, but there's an issue that Ephesians touches on, Colossians does too, it's also in the pastoral epistles, and it's the kind of issue that we could have a whole class on. You could call it a social issue or a background issue. Things that are the topics of lifetimes of study that are background to the material. The New Testament mentions something and assumes that you know what they're talking about. We just read about marriage. Well, what was marriage in the Roman world? And what was marriage like at Ephesus if you were Greek and not Roman? And what was marriage like if you were Jewish, but you were Greek-speaking and lived in Alexandria? And how is that different than Mary and Joseph in Galilee? You know, marriage and family was different across the Roman Empire. And that's just one social topic. A topic that gets talked about a lot today in the New Testament is slavery. And at worst, it gets used, the topic gets used to discredit the New Testament. Because the New Testament was used, especially in the old American South, to justify slavery. And the Roman world was a world full of slavery. And modern social reformers read the New Testament and they say, well, the Christians didn't really fight against it. They accepted it. And there are other things in the Bible that are just accepted, and that shows that the Bible is sort of pre-civilization, or at least it's an ancient civilization that we really can't view it as authoritative for us in our setting. So I'd like to read a few of these passages. One of them is Ephesians 6, verses 5 through 9. Slaves, obey your earthly masters. This is Ephesians 6, beginning in verse 5. With fear and trembling, with a sincere heart, as you would Christ. Not by the way of eye service as people pleasers, but as servants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with a good will, as to the Lord and not to man. Knowing that whatever good anyone does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is a slave or free. And then masters, do the same to them and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and that there is no partiality with him. A very abbreviated counsel, just as in Ephesians 6, there are four lines to children and to fathers. But we call this the economy of the text. They just touch on things in a very succinct way. Then in Colossians chapter 3, Colossians 3, a briefer passage, beginning in verse 22, Colossians 3:22, slaves, obey in everything those who are your earthly masters, not by way of eye service as people pleasers, but with sincerity of heart, fearing the Lord. Whatever you do, work heartily, as for the Lord, and not for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. That's the Abrahamic inheritance. You are serving the Lord Christ. Of course, they're serving their master too, but in the end, they're serving Christ. For the wrongdoer, that is the slave who doesn't serve well, will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality. Masters, treat your slaves justly and fairly, knowing that you also have a master in heaven. And then thirdly, on the board, and later today we'll get to the pastoral epistles, but there is this verse, among others in 1 Timothy 6, let all who are under a yoke as bondservants, that's the NIV 2011, it would be translated as slaves in the ESV, regard their own masters as worthy of all honor, so that the name of God and the teaching may not be reviled. Now, you don't have this in your notes, so we'll just have to follow it on the board here. But this is from a commentary I'm writing on the pastoral epistles, and I add some stuff to it yesterday, and I thought, well, this would be a good place to sort of test fly this description of slavery. And there's one paragraph in particular I want you to pay attention to. But think of that verse, "Let all who are under a yoke regard their masters as worthy of honor." Having reflected on pressing priorities regarding widows, elders, and Timothy himself at the end of chapter 5, Paul now has brief counsel for slaves. Paul regarded himself and Timothy as slaves of Christ. Douloi means slaves. And when he says, "let all," that signals that this holds true for every person in this social class who is under Timothy's pastoral guidance, all the slaves in the church at Ephesus. The emphasis on the individual that has characterized this subsection going back to chapter 5:1 continues. So it's not just a letter to the church or to the world, but to individuals. Yoke of slavery is a term found in classical Greek writers. And Jesus used the yoke as a metaphor for being his disciple. "Take my yoke on you." Slavery was onerous. It was a load. And it was undesirable to be a slave. But it was universal across the Roman Empire. And indeed, across most civilizations until fairly recent times. It is still currently by no means eradicated. And I'll come back to that. In hierarchical societies like that of Ephesus, where most people were born into their predetermined niches in the social complex, slaves were simply at the bottom of a long continuum of varying levels of subordination based on birth. So from the emperor down, everybody was born into a situation, and that was your lot in life. And remember, lifespans were something on the order of 30 years. So once you became an adult, you didn't have long, and then in all likelihood, you were going to be dead. Paul urged slaves who could attain freedom to do so. He called on Philemon to receive his escaped slave Onesimus back as a brother. Yet, like other New Testament figures, including Jesus, Paul's immediate goal in ministry was not revolutionary change of the social order. It was preaching and teaching the gospel for the sake of establishing enclaves of Christian believers and thereby ultimately redeeming the world. Christianity did not understand itself to be a revolutionary movement, even though its teachings had clear reformatory implications. And that's Juette Bassler's comment in her commentary. In due course, this could and did challenge corrupt institutions like slavery. And it's really through the influence of Christianity in the world that slavery gradually was abolished in most of the world. We should point out that societies that are free from slavery, and let's just say the United States is free from slavery, although we do have sex trafficking and probably other kinds of economic oppression that are worse than ancient slavery was, where it exists, even societies free from slavery are still corrupt due to pervasive human sin and oppression by other means. And this is the paragraph that I think is most important when I want to share with you. To say, as one scholar does, that the pastorals, so 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Titus, endorse the cruelty of Greco-Roman society without reflection. That's something you read a lot in scholarship. This harsh criticism of, well, they don't think Paul wrote the pastorals, but often Paul still gets blamed for what somebody wrote in his name. They endorsed the cruelty of slavery. Now, I don't know if you felt like what I just read from Ephesians and Colossians was endorsing the cruelty of slavery. I don't think it was. But because it doesn't attack it and call for a revolution against it, then it endorses the cruelty. So I want to respond to that. To say that the pastorals endorse the cruelty of Greco-Roman society without reflection may be technically true. I think that might be a misprint. I think it's actually the cruelty of Greco-Roman slavery. I think I typed society, but I'll check on that. But I think it's Greco-Roman slavery. May be true, but it is first of all anachronistic. You know, it's like criticizing medieval knights because they didn't use AK-47s. Well, there weren't any. Known social orders free of slavery did not exist. In the Roman world, wherever you went, if people had conquered other peoples, the conquered peoples became the slaves. That's just the way the whole world was. It would be like condemning today's church 1,000 years from now because it did not speak out against traffic deaths. We can't live without cars. They couldn't live without slaves. In cities in particular, sometimes the majority of the population was slave. They didn't have engines. They didn't have a lot of art conveniences, and it's slaves that made things work. And now you can read up on this, but there were slaves actually that were almost like household members. You know, they were tutors of children, and they did lots of things that weren't demeaning. And then there were slaves that were demeaned, and it was horrible. But not everybody was in a horrible slave situation. Second, we need to remember that today there are estimated to be 45 million slaves in the world. And I've got the footnote if you want that information. And that's not appreciably fewer than would have existed in the Roman Empire. Roman Empire is estimated to have been around 100 million people. And so probably something like 40% of the Roman Empire, maybe 30%, were slaves. So we may have more slaves on earth today than they had in the first century. Of course, our population is much larger. But still, that's a lot of people living in slavery right now. And it's going to get worse here, all right? So I'm glad you had your lunch a few minutes ago. Thirdly, it appears that statement, the pastorals endorse the cruelty of Greco-Roman slavery. That statement appears to assume the superiority of contemporary social orders. We're not like that. We're less cruel. We would not condone such practices. Yet the 20th century was the most brutal in human history measured by the loss of life in war and genocide. If you figure it up, historians say that 200 million people died in the 20th century from wars and genocide. If you do the math, that's 35,000 people a day for a century. The pace does not seem to be slowing at present. There are still thousands of people a day dying from war and genocide. I mentioned this yesterday, or take persecution of Christians. One agency says 1,200 a year, another says 90,000 a year. How civilized is modern civilization? In which, and you might want to look this up, it's in a Middle Eastern scholarly journal. This article is written by two Germans. They document, this is an issue I ran into in Sudan a lot, there are 200 million people on earth today, all women, who are coping with genital mutilation, most under the aegis of the world's second largest religion, that's Islam. And the point of this article was to document in a scholarly way that although the Western media denies it, and many in Islam deny it, in much of the Islamic world, it's universal. That at some age, typically when you reach puberty, if you're a girl, then your genitals are mutilated. And I won't go into more detail, but it's traumatic. It's traumatic physically, it's traumatic physiologically. It casts a pall over the marriage, if the girl is married or going to be married, for the rest of her life. And it's a deep, deep scar. And it's not something that happens, you know, in some little corner in some remote place. That figure of 200 million was 130 million until, and this is a 2016 New York Times article that updated to 200,000 because social scientists have just documented how widespread it is in Indonesia. Indonesia, the largest, it's the largest Muslim country in the world. And until very recently, there was widespread denial that this happened. But when they realized the scale of it in Indonesia, it's virtually universal, and that raised it to, that raised it by 70 million. So that's the effect of a religion in the world. And we're going to criticize the ancient world for slavery? And we've got 200 million women on the face of the earth. It's all swept under the rug. Now, if you're one of those women, it's not swept under the rug. And the Muslim convert women that I ministered to in Africa for better part of 10 years, I found out in the course of my dealings with this tribe that this was a major problem in all their lives and in their marriages. And now that they were becoming Christian, they were beginning to find resources to forgive and to receive the comfort of God and the affirmation of husbands and wives, where before there had been a lot of bitterness and resentment and even physical issues. Also, how civilized is modern civilization when we live in a world where today over a billion babies have died by abortion? And the worldwide figure right now is about 56 million a year. 56 million a year terminated. So, in light of the low moral ground, we hear of high moral ground. In light of the low moral ground that modern commentators occupy, you know, I, as a commentator on the Bible in 2017, what kind of a world do I live in? Do I stand on this high pinnacle of civilization's achievement that I can look back at what they say about slavery in the New Testament epistles and say, oh, you barbarians, we are so superior to you morally. We don't have to take what you say about social order seriously, because look at what we have attained. And we don't believe in the gospel. What have we attained? You know, as was it Alexander Graham Bell that said, what has God wrought, or was it Watson, his assistant? Or, you know, somebody said, what has God wrought when the phone was invented? In the light of our low moral ground, pastoral epistle and other New Testament passages, like we read in Ephesians and Colossians, should get credit for calling for and enabling revolutionary ties between slaves and their owners, respect for each other, responsibility toward each other. Being an owner in the light of the fact you're going to answer to your master, buddy. So you better treat your slave as a brother or sister in the Lord and not victimize them and oppress them, as was your legal right in that social order. They should not be criticized for failing to leave adequate record of direct condemnation of then global economic and social orders. So this may not be an issue for you and for me. Our ancestors probably weren't slaves. If you're an African American, it's a big issue. And the more that we move into an era where we hope that in our churches we have more people of color and we mingle with them more and more, we should understand this is going to be more and more of an issue in the Bible. Why doesn't the Bible condemn slavery more? And we could wish that the Bible would have said all kinds of things. And why didn't Jesus heal more people? Why didn't he live on earth for 30 years and heal everybody? You know, there are all kinds of things we could think up to criticize the way that God did what he did that's recorded in the Bible. But, you know, we want to be even-handed, and most of all, I was thinking about this morning, especially be humble and be reluctant. Be reluctant to criticize the Bible. There's a lot in it I don't understand. You know, I read the Old Testament through every year, and when I read Leviticus and Numbers, and there's a lot of that stuff I don't understand. And then, you know, you can read what the scholars say, and you get some light on it, but even then, sometimes scholars say, well, you know, we don't know really what this is about, especially a lot of the purity laws and, you know, clothes you could wear and things you could eat. And I mean, why? We don't have all the information we would like to have. But I think we want to be careful about criticizing the Bible because it's not as avant-garde as we are or as sophisticated as we are. Because when you look at our world, especially with the help of technology, you know, we benefit from it. We got fast food and cars and cell phones and stuff like that. But the downside of technology, of course, is the reason that you could kill people at the rate of 35,000 a day for 100 years in the 20th century is the invention of the machine gun and the refining of explosives. And then also social philosophies that were enabled by the technology of rapid mass communication. You know, TV, radio, other means of coercion of a populace. I talked back when I was much younger, now these people would be dead, but I talked to a lot of people who lived through the 1930s in Germany. And one of the things that the people who lived through that era often told me was, we didn't know what was happening. Because it was a police state and Hitler controlled all the radio. And Germany, east and west, that's a pretty big place. And if you lived in the south and something was happening up in the north, or even over in Bavaria, and you're a Schwabian in the southwest, how are you going to know if it's a police state and communications are all being dictated to by the Gestapo? That kind of oppression on that scale and rapidity, it wasn't possible until you had electronics and you had, as I said, explosives and armored columns and tanks and planes and bombs and all that kind of thing. And then philosophies like Bolshevism or communism that justified 5 or 6 million dead in the Ukraine, you know, 6 million Jews dead, 3 million Vietnamese and Cambodians dead. You know, you start adding up the 3, 5, 10, 15 millions. The 2 million Armenians killed by the Turks, you know, all this was done in a century that it couldn't have been done earlier because they couldn't kill people that fast. Now we can kill people faster than has ever been done before. And so we're better than the Roman world. I don't think so. To return to Colossians, just before we take a break, Colossians is dominated by the doctrine of Christ, viewed from four angles. One, his supremacy, especially as is stated in 1:15 through 20. And maybe you could just turn there and follow along. Colossians 1:15. Christ is the image. The word there in Greek is eikon. We get the word icon from it. He's the image of the invisible God. You know, God the Father in heaven is invisible. He's spirit. We can't see him. But he took on flesh, and that's Christ. He's the firstborn of all creation. Firstborn here doesn't mean, doesn't refer to his birth. Firstborn here means pride of place. He is the honored one. God calls Israel his firstborn. It's his chosen people. It's a term of honor, not a term of chronology. For by him all things were created, and that means by means of. God the Father is the creator. God the Son is God's agent of creation. So, you know, if you care to listen to me on this, and it's a free country, you can do whatever you want, please don't say Jesus created the world. Please don't say Jesus created the world. The first person of the Trinity, the Father, is the creator. And when it says by him, it's the preposition en, which means in, with, or by. And then auto refers to Christ, him. So it's by means of the Son. All things were created. And notice that's passive, were created. Who's the subject of the sentence? God the Father. God the Father created by means of the Son. So Jesus didn't create the world. God the Father created the world. Also, remember that until the incarnation, we talk about God the Son, or we talk about the Son of God, or we talk about the second person of the Trinity. Flesh, humanity, is not eternal. Jesus didn't exist before the incarnation. The Son of God existed. The second person of the Trinity existed. But Jesus took on flesh at the time of Caesar Augustus. So that's the other problem with saying Jesus created the world, because then you give the impression that the man Jesus existed before creation. And creation didn't exist before creation. Only God in his transcendence existed before the created order. So I say this just because some people, in a well-meaning attempt to exalt Jesus, overstate his role in creation. It's through the Son that all things were created. And John 1 says that by him all things were created. Same construction, through the Son. He is the... He's the point of contact. See, God the Father is spiritual, and there's nothing physical to him. You say, well, what is he? I don't know. He's God. God is God. But there's a point of contact where God has entered our world, and through which the spiritual spoke into being the material, and that point of contact is the Son. It's through him that God the Father spoke into existence that which is created with the aid and in the presence of the Holy Spirit. And the Spirit of the Lord hovered over the face of the deep in Genesis 1. God the Father, Son, and Spirit were all active in creation. But there's a division of labor in the Godhead. So we've got the world created. For by him all things were created in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or rulers or authorities, all things were created through him and for him. Notice again, we're created, passive. God the Father did it through him and for him. He is before all things. Jehovah Witness Bible inserts the word other there. And they need to. Because the Jehovah Witnesses teach that Christ was created. And if it says he is before all things, then that says he's not a thing. He existed before any created thing existed. And that's what Paul writes. But that doesn't fit in with Jehovah's Witness theology. So if you get a New World Translation, look it up, and you'll see the word other there. They put the word other so that they can argue, look, it says right there he's part of the created order, but it's not in the Greek. And in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent. That's my seminary's motto. In him, everything preeminent. For in him, all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. There's that motif of social reconciliation again. He made peace. Number two, Colossians presents Christ as the basis for repudiating gospel twisting. When you read Colossians 2, you'll see that there are people that are deceiving the Colossians, and Paul wants to he writes this letter to counteract that. He didn't found the church at Colossae. He's never been to Colossae, but in prison, he gets word from one of his assistants that was saved at Ephesus, who went back to his hometown of Colossae and founded a church there, Epaphroditus. And Epaphroditus then visits Paul in jail, and tells him what's going on. And so Paul writes this letter to say, I don't like what I'm hearing here. If anybody comes trying to delude you with persuasive arguments, remember that Christ is the one in whom all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden. Thirdly, Colossians presents believers' union with Christ as the ultimate game changer for daily living. Chapter 3, verse 2, set your mind on the things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. Driving in from Interstate 55, or is it 255 over there this morning, when you get to the Our Lady of the Snows or something down there? They got a nice banner up right now, and there's a crucifixion scene, and it says, we were there. And there's a couple ways you could take that. Ways you could take it. Number one, we're sinners too, and we would have called for his death also. There's another way you can take it, which is right here. You have died. When did you die? You died when Christ was crucified for your sins. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. Galatians 2:20. So this is my point here. Our union with Christ is the ultimate game changer for daily living. Because we pass from the death of our pre-Christ life to the reality of a life in which something changed under Pontius Pilate for us. And when we confess Jesus as our Lord, then his death becomes our death. And it's profound. He says, for you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. In other words, your destiny, your perfected being, will be manifest when Christ returns and we are made like him, because we will see him as he is. Our future identity is already present with him, because our past sinful identity went to the grave when he died. Sounds very mystical, doesn't it? But when you read Colossians 3, and it talks about putting to death sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, you know, it talks about a change in how we live. It's not just saying, be better, be different. That's not Christianity. Christianity is not moralism. You know, Christianity is Christ crucified. And we were there. And he rose, and he sits at God's right hand, and our lives are hidden with him in God. And we'll see what it all means when he returns. But right now, we're growing in that relationship of trust that Jesus' death is our life, and we're growing into what that means. What does it mean that my life is hidden with God in Christ? And we're working that out day by day. And that's one reason we need to be in church on Sunday, is to be fed the Word of God so that the Holy Spirit can work in us and keep expanding our horizons and keep calling us to repentance and keep drawing us toward holiness and service and bringing honor and glory to God. And at that point, I want to give you 5 minutes so that you can stay alert. See you in 5 minutes.